Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am Wade Price, delighted to be joined once more by the great and powerful Louise Sugden to talk all about her excellent Snakebite Ork army. Wah, and welcome to you, Louise. Well met.
Wah, and welcome to you, Wade. I am very excited to be here. I think this is going to be, it's every young hobbyist's dream to talk about their army for an hour, so I'm really excited.
And you've definitely put the work into this. We might have to be forcibly restrained after an hour of exuding a lot of enthusiasm over the kitbashes and collections and lore that you've developed for your expansive Snakebite collection. And I know for the purposes of the video version of this podcast, you have a lot of your orc models in front of you, and you'll probably bring them up and tell us their names and make the noises. We'll probably drop some pictures into the finished version. But if anyone wants to look at what we're talking about, listening to the audio version of the podcast, your Instagram page has loads of this stuff that we'll be looking at and talking about. Savage underscore orc underscore guy is the image, I believe.
I think you can also just like look Louise Sugden and it comes up as well. So
however you prefer to interact with Instagram, those are the details to go for. So this lovely Snakebite collection, why did you happen upon the Snakebites of all the wondrous orc clans of the 41st millennium? What drew you to the Snakebites?
It was a really tricky decision to make because as a new hobbyist, I had the picture book open in front of me and it's essentially like, which of the pictures do you like the best? So there was a lot of, to-ing and fro-ing. And I think I decided I liked the snake bites best just because of their commitment to fur and animals and stuff like that. So I think that's the essential decision that I made, was I just wanted to build my army around a lot of pets and a lot of character as opposed to a lot of vehicles. I'm not huge on painting vehicles either. I like painting organic things a lot more. So I think that just naturally kind of happened.
And what were the sources of inspiration or reference? What were the codexes or books at the time?
A lot of 7th edition was where I started really building like the cooler, what I considered to be the cooler miniatures in my army. But a lot of really old stuff. Like, remember those old pictures of snake bites, and they're really colorful and they have those lovely big banners. I'm sure we can get pictures of that somewhere. Mm. Do you remember which edition that was?
My mind goes back all the way to 1st edition. They used to be the books. Yeah. Remember War of the Orks, which was the
introduction. I got it on my bookshelf. Yeah.
Of course I do. Was the follow-up book that had the rules for goths and blood axes and snake points, I think. And the artwork.
I think that was the one. I remember it in my head now because it had that page where it has all the orcs with the banners and stuff. And obviously they're very bright colored and they have all those checkers and different tattoos and stuff. And that just really spoke to me in a big way. So that was it, yeah.
I was having a look over the Here We Go book in preparation for doing a Snakebite flavored podcast because there was the classic Snakebite artwork and rules, and the great Jervis Johnson rolled up Ugelhard's Charges, I think a sample Snakebite warband that included a Snakebite run hood by the name of Zodgrod.
We recognize that name now. That's really exciting that he's back. He looks like he's let himself go a bit, which is absolutely what a Snakebite run hood would do over the course of 20 years.
And the rest, I reckon.
And the rest.
Good time. So there's been an abundance of Snakebite imagery and source material out there. You've got a very distinctive Snakebite orc army, and I'd like to know a little bit more about them. So who are your Snakebites, and how did they come to be in the lore?
Well, that's a really long story, because I've been painting them for a very long time. So it started with the miniatures that I had at the time, which was the Black Reach War Boss. And he's a pretty standard War Boss. He's a bit dated. At this point, he's looking a bit old, but that's absolutely fine. I started with what I had. And the story is that he and his pretty standard Orqua essentially crash landed into a planet. And that planet, little did they know, was full of feral orcs. Very lucky. Well, actually not so lucky, because it ended up that the war boss of the current Wa had a fight with the war boss of the Snakebites, which they found on that planet. And he essentially ended up getting defeated by the war boss known as Scargrim Snake Eater. And I have a miniature for him right here. He's a big boy. And what he did was he stole the claw off my original war boss. And now he is the leader of the combined forces of the Snakebites from the planet, which they landed on, and the other orcs, which crashed on the planet, and they formed a kind of, I wouldn't say harmonious society, because there's a lot of infighting, but certainly they've, combined their technologies of these big killer cans and this orky sort of classic orky stuff with, you know, the feralness of the animals they already had on the planet. And it's a whole big fun mess. And that's kind of the story of where they started.
That sounds like it gives you quite a bit of freedom to explore more classic orky clan snakebite tropes, but also look at the feral orcs, the wild boys. I'd imagine maybe in the future some of the beast snaggers.
I'm so excited for those. Yeah, yeah, they would fit right in because, like you said, there is a lot of freedom within the lore that I've created to say, well, this half is the half that, you know, crashed on the planet, so of course they use more tech. But this half is the ones that, you know, they started on the feral planet. They've just come out the jungle. They found a gun and they've gone, oh, this is fun. Which is a lot of my army is tapping into that kind of, we're feral orcs that found guns and now this is fun.
You've got feral orcs done good and other orcs who have gone native.
Yeah. Other orcs that have just like found a boar and is like, oh, we can put rockets on that. That's cool. Mm. And ones that already had a boar that is like, we can also put rockets on that. They get along, you know, as far as ideas go, they're pretty on the same level.
Yeah, and there's a sense of kind of gestalt orcishness around the universe where different ideas will resonate with orcs. And I can imagine that some orcs, well, the same orcs might look upon a truck or look upon a squig and say, it's just a big stumpy, shouty, noisy monster, isn't it? You can crush humans with it. You can ride on it. You can put guns on it. They're kind of interchangeable. There's a lot of philosophical chats and talkings going on.
Yeah. They're all on the same page. Like if it can hit real good, then we like it. If it can crump, we're happy with it. So, yeah.
Your Skargrim Warboss that you show there, that's the conversion of Gorbad Ironclaw.
Yes.
Feared orc warlords of the world that was in the old world. But he's got a fantastic combination of bits on him because he's that classic orc and goblin warlord, but then he's got savage orc or bone splitter tribal fetishes and staffs.
Yes.
And my favorite bit, I think, those shooters that he's got mounted on the front of.
Oh, absolutely. It was one of my favorite conversions I've ever done because I love the base miniature. The base miniature is just such a good base miniature. And I felt a bit guilty making it so, I don't know, almost sacrilegious with the amount of snakebite stuff I put on it. But honestly, it's really one of my favorites. I'm trying to remember all the kits I used from it. I think there's a lot of the just basic Savage Orc kit from Age of Sigmar, which was then Warhammer Fantasy. And I think that's still, when people are like, what's your favorite kit? The basic Savage Orc kit is still one of my absolute favorites, just for the amount of bits that you get for it. Like, it's those two guys carrying the big spear, and that's what you see is his main weapon, his throwing weapon, is that massive spear, which is usually carried by two orcs. He can do it himself because he's quite big. Just attaching little guns and little exhausts underneath the boar to everything. He's having a great time. He's a really fun miniature to play as well. I really like having him on the tabletop because I run him as a war boss on a bike, obviously. So he's very good in game as well.
And at what point in real world history did that warlord usurp the Assault on Blackreach edition Snakebite boss? When did he come to be?
I would say about 7 years ago. I would say 6 to 7 years ago. I think that's because the pictures that I remember having are ones where I'm in like second year of uni, if we're talking real world times. Yeah, because that's kind of when I started saying, all right, I've got my snake bites. I like them, but I want them to be, you know, I want to put some of my own flavor into them. I really want to have these boar boys and these you know, pig riders and all the other things that I decided to do, like later on my squigs and all my squigoths and stuff. I think that's when I decided, like, all right, I've got my basics. Now I'm going to add to it and make it really my own, which is really great.
So did that model sort of set a standard of the sorts of kitmashes and conversions that you'd want to do with the rest of the army?
I think so. I was trying to remember this earlier on. I was like, what was my first conversion? Like, what was the tipping point? When did I say, I'm going to stop, you know, just painting tattoos on 40K orcs and I'm going to start doing this? I think it was him. I think it was also the first time I realized that you could just chop the hand off a 40K boy and stick it on a Savage Orc. And it's like, huh, that works. Like, that just, yeah, I've got a few here, I think, examples of just that really basic conversion where, yeah, you just chop the hand of a 40K orc and stick it on a Savage Orc, and you've got a whole new guy. I think that was the tilting point where I realized, actually, this is quite easy. I'm just thinking.
You've got other characters as well, haven't you? As well.
Oh,
as
absolutely. Yeah. If you think I only have one war boss, you're wrong. There's so much more to this lore. No. It wasn't all hunky dory when they crash landed. No, not at all. Because as well as the big guy, there was also a runt herd who was also trying to take all the glory. And they thought they got rid of him a long time ago, but actually he came back. And this is Snagifying. And he is, yeah, he's a big guy. You can see, similar to Zogrod, when he was away, he spent some time buffing up. And he was the most powerful runt herd on the planet. He would train up the best animals. You could give him any animal, he would, you know, train it up to be huge and intimidating. And he is the second war boss within my Snakebite army. And he basically controls all the animals. So if you see an animal in my army, it's because he's injected it with some horrible stuff and has basically run with it. So there's two sort of lists I like to play in. There's one which is ran by Scargrim Snake Eater, and he runs all the tech. He kind of runs the more techie things. So if I've got the Death Dread and the Killicans and the Planes and the Battle Wagons, those are his. If you see Squigs and Boars and other things like that coming out, they're probably Snagafangs. So, yeah.
Snagafang made of to give him that imposing physique?
Well, that's a really good question, because I do have an answer for that, and I love it when you ask these questions. There is a certain ritual on the planet for young orcs, and it is to eat the head of a very venomous snake. And if you survive, you become extremely strong. If you die, yeah, you're not worth it. So as you can see on him, he has got a lot of those snakes kicking around, because he's probably been eating them for a long time. They're on his face, they're on his... on a silly stick at the back, which I can take off. It's magnetized. That's fun. But there is a ritual on the planet in which you eat the snakes, the venomous snakes, and if you survive, you become powerful. And that's why he's so big.
He's got the nice combination of the war boss shooters paired on the back with an extra bit of savage orc fetishes or totems. Again, just changes up the silhouette and lets you know. He's got a bit of tech about him, but...
Oh, he has. He's absolutely, he's on board with the tech. He's got a massive claw. He loves that. Love that claw. The base miniature is an ogre, I think, that I got with the Thunder Tusk thing. And I think that's quite fun for orcs, because you can paint it green and it does scale really well with the savage orc heads. And you can create these big lumbering orcs, which I just think is a great conversion as well. Really easy to do.
It's fantastic. I'm sure there'll be plenty of people giving it a crack after seeing that.
I hope so.
So we've got a sense of the figures in command, and you've already alluded to the fact that there's some vehicles and there's some monsters. I get the sense in the game some of the monsters play like vehicles, but this is a thematic background sort of distinction I need to make.
I have a lot of so for example, I have a lot of trucks in my army, and not a single one of those trucks has wheels. None of them have wheels. One of the main things I decided to do for trucks is use Lizardman models, which, looking back, is a bold choice, a very bold choice. But a lot of the Lizardman kits really worked well with my Snakebite army, because they do have those snake fetishes and those lovely lizard sort of pieces on them. So the conversion-wise, it just made sense. This is a truck with a twin-link shooter. You can see it on top. Yep. Yeah. And like I said, this is one of Snagafang's boys. So you can see he's just come out the jungle with his best friend, and he's just attached some guns to it. And he's like, this is great. So
get on board, lads.
Exactly. Yeah. And I have a few of those like that. Let's have a look at the other ones. Why not? Yeah. Why not? Since we're here, this is very exciting for me. And this is the Vistilodon one. You could easily paint that red, have it a squig, but I just chose to make it the animals that they already had on their planet, and they've just decided to attach guns to it because that's what they love to do best.
You get a rake of snakes with that kit as well.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite parts of that kit is coming out those little stone things just hordes of snakes, which, you know, you can see I've used it on loads of my miniatures. On the base of my war boss there, you can see some of those snakes. That was a great kit. My bits box is just a delight after buying that kit. Such a good kit.
Have you made use of any of the splintered fang components from Warcry? Because there's a big base of snakes.
Oh, the snake crawler. Yeah. I'm very excited to do that. I do plan on expanding my snake bites. I'm sure we'll talk about that later when we get to it. But yeah, there's so many kits now that would be just perfect for smacking into some orc kits and making some really great conversions. But yeah, that's definitely one of them that I've had my eye on for a while.
You've shown with those Seraphites, every kit can be an orc kit if you approach it the right way. You stick orc glyphs and plates on it, that really helps. But pretty much it can be.
You see, the orc players maybe are the most creative players out there, because they'll be given anything, like, and they'll make it orky. And I think I really like that. I've seen some great Tau battle suits become orky. Even orky kits that you've never imagined being used like that become even orkier with creative kit bashers. I think that's really great.
Can people take the kind of the Megatrack scrap jet, the downed flyer that's been turned into a buggy, and people put wings back on them and make them into planes again? Or
I've seen some crazy orc flyers. Like I think I saw one time on the internet, and it was someone had just made the biggest pirate ship you can imagine, and it was just dense with detail. And I just think that's so great. I'd love to do something like that one day for Armies on Parade, is just make just a massive just orc vehicle. Like a dreadfully orc thing, and it would be so good, but I don't have the time.
maybe one day, maybe next year. Maybe next year. You said using those big lizard men Seraphon beasties was a bold choice. They look fantastic. Why do you say it was bold?
Thank you.
Big carrots of area that you can fill with color for your striking looking armies.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of the Age of Sigmar miniatures are like that, and even the 40k one. Like I've got my little my first ever Squiggoth here, and this was my first ever Forge World miniature. I was so happy to get it, and all the panels, you can make it snake bitey, just paint it like a snake. My battle wagons are all possessed by the spirits of dead squigs and squigoths even, so that's always fun. They don't have names yet. I feel like they were just the war boss's favorite squigoth, who died and then came back as a battle wagon, because I'll get a picture of my battle wagons here, and they all have the tusks of the squigoths attached to the side of the wagon, and then they become possessed by the squigoth and they get to keep on fighting, which is really good fun.
Do the orcs know that the spirits of the squigoths possess
absolutely. The wagon? Absolutely. Yeah. They take care of the battle wagons. They all have fields to roam in when they're not fighting. Yeah.
And that kind of just reinforces that idea of those two cultures meeting in the middle to create what your force is. They've got a bit of tech. They've got a bit of in touch with the old ways of bests that the snake bites have passed on to them. Just fusing them together, thinking of their
there's a lot of magic, I think, going on. There's a lot of warpy goodness going on that planet. There's a lot of weird, you know, because I've got Warzag, the old weird boy. There's a lot of spooky magic going on. I really like tapping into that kind of orky magic as well, because I don't think it's utilized enough. Orcs are spooky. They've got some spooky stuff going on. Yeah. So
Imperium just has no idea what's going on. It's weird primitive magic. Don't worry about it. Just it's yawning fine. Giant green feet into existence. You can't just ignore that. They're crushing even less battle.
Yeah. It's the, what was that rule called? Like the foot of Mork or Gork? You could just summon a green foot to just stamp on someone. I love that. I think that's
the alien gods are not real. Big foot manifests and crushes your tank. Well, that one might be, but the rest of them are all really.
Ignore that giant foot. The rest is fine.
So what role does the weird boy play in the structure and the power struggles of your...
He's on the fringes. He's definitely... He just appears sometimes to cause some trouble. Like, I think in the rules in 7th, you can teleport vehicles. Tell me if I'm wrong. But and he would just, you know, pop up on a squigoth, teleport it to the other side of the table and just vanish. And everyone's like, yep, there he goes. That was good.
That's why you're never in charge. It's one of the two war bosses, but never you. You have a role to play, not being in charge.
Oh, that's part of the fun. It's part of the fun.
Because that was part of some of the older weird boys background, some of those older weird boys miniatures. They came with orcs restraining them to make sure they didn't blow anything up they shouldn't do.
I love that. I know the one you're thinking about, the one with all the chains and he's just like floating and stuff. Yeah, my ones, he's not restrained. He just zip zaps wherever he wants. And he's a bit of no one really talks to him. He's just a bit weird.
you keep your distance. Absolutely. So I've had a look at some of the actual legit vehicles that you've got as well. Overgrown green jungly foliage coming over those red wagons and such like that. Have you settled on the scheme, because the color schemes for the vehicles seems quite unified. Is that how they looked when they turned up on the planet? And there's just lots of multicolored creatures.
No. They've been left in the jungle for a very long time. They've essentially, there's not much maintenance going on, I think, of them. And the planet itself is very overgrown. So, you know, they park their battle wagon, and then they just let whatever happens to it. And that's why when you see my battle wagon, it's got a lot of foliage on it, and it's got a lot of green. They're drawing things on it occasionally. There's a load of arrows sticking out for it. They go through a lot and they're never cleaned. So I think that's kind of what I try to emulate when, you know, it's coming out on the battle. It's just coming out the jungle for the first time in a very long time. And I it's such a fun thing to do, because it means you can be a bit messier.
Falling out of it as it rumbles around and moves about. You got the horns and tusks from the Ogre Kingdom to the East Claw Raiders, I guess, Ogre's sub-faction. Yep. That is a great way of breaking up the silhouette and making them really distinctive. And you take some bits away from the stone horns or the thunder tusks that you use as beasts and stick them onto the trucks. Yep. You've just shake all the bits around and see what falls out.
It's a lot of fun to do these vehicles. And I had such a good time painting them back in the day. And I can paint them really quickly because I'm not trying to edge highlight everything. I'm using a lot of stippling to get that rust effect. And I think it's really good and really effective. And I think I'd like to do more, because it's kind of like, I've been doing so many edge highlights, Wade, and I just, you know, just let loose a little bit and just throw some paint at a battle wagon, stick some horns on it, and call it a squig off. It's great.
Give it a name, call it Stampy number 2, and send Stampy it off into 3. The world. I'm in a similar kind of place at the moment. I've spent a lot of time edge highlighting stuff, and I'm currently painting Aeronautica Imperialis Orc Planes. It feels like it's cheating. They just take the paint too easily and too quickly, and it's too much fun, but I'm building my wire energies up. I did my Orc Blood Bowl team a couple of weeks ago, Orc Aeronautica Imperialis stuff. I'm getting myself ready for some 40k Orc stuff, and I think Snakebites is where my heart really lies.
It's the best. I feel like before, you know, recently, I think they weren't talked about as much as the other clans. I feel like I felt a bit hard done by. I felt like the other clans got way more love. And I remember starting Forge World, and I was big into my snake bites at that time. And I think I was laying out one of the monster books, and I remember I got to pick what we did for the orc page, and I put a snake bite symbol right smack bang in the middle, and that felt like a victory to me. Mm. It felt like a big victory. And now, like recently with the Beast Snaggers coming out, the Orc Codex has what is essentially snake bites on the front. And it's such a good time to be alive. I'm delighted. Like 20-year-old Louise is absolutely delighted to see Snakebites getting the love I think they deserve.
Snakebites kind of had Zodgrod Wartsnagger holding the banner for the Snakebite. What's your favorite thing? I love grots.
Yeah, personally, I'm a grot sympathizer. I love grots. I'm very much down for them. But in 40K, I feel like they get the rough end of the stick.
Yeah, they are like mine clearance squads in the main, or bullet catchers with various persuasions for the orcs. Have you not got any bullet catching Gretchen in your collection?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I have some stories about them. I feel like the good stories in my Snakebite army are always coming from the underdogs. I have some great ones where a couple of squigs and a runt herd zapped a land raider and killed it in one go. That was great. Lots of sixes. That was a solid victory. And the runts, I ran them up and they all just took down an assassin one day, and that was so I certainly have a lot of time for them. They do their job on the tabletop. No one ever shoots at them. They're too small, and then they get you. That's
how they get you. Drag you down.
Yeah, you're shooting all the big guys. Look down, grots banging your ankle. What you can do?
So what kind of other converted units do you have outside of the big vehicles and the beasties and the characters that we've seen?
As far as my favorite unit goes, it's my boar boys. I spent a lot of time doing them, and they're really good in the game because I run them as bikes, and bikes in, I think, with any army are really good on the tabletop. So they're definitely worth having. And let's get boar boy out. These are, I think it's just a savage orc on a boar kit. Some guns attached to it.
Slugger and shooters around the head.
And the classic shooter. But they just look so fun on the tabletop. I run them with my war boss on a boar on them, and they all just go together as a big team, and they just annihilate everything on the board. I was going to upgrade them with claws, and that's just mean. That's just nasty. It's just six boar boys with claws and guns coming at you. Horrible. The what was the miniatures that came out pretty recently? The Gore Grunters, which were the big Oryx on the boars that came. Yeah, I was going to do those up as essentially knobs on boars because they are so chunky. And I got as far as converting them, and this is shameful. And I'm sure everybody has the same situation where they have their boxes of shame of unbuilt, unassembled miniatures. And then there's the conversions of shame. I feel like those don't get enough, you know, attention, because a lot of the time you will convert these amazing miniatures and then you just don't paint them. And I have a lot of that. And the Gore Grunter Boar Boys are, I think, my favorite to-do list miniatures, because they're so big, so chunky.
Put them up on social media and let people behold them after saying that, because
I should. Oh, they're only half—they're undercoated. It's shameful. I need to paint them now. I've said it. I'm gonna have to paint them.
Must. Are you familiar with the condition sometimes people experience that finished miniatures that they post on social media may get fewer likes than the work in progress or unpainted miniatures?
Yeah. This is so common that you'll be casually painting. If you use social media, you'll post a work in progress. People love to see work in progresses, and it'll, you know, people be like, wow, I can't wait to see how this turns out. And you're like, yeah, I'm really excited. And then you post your finished one and it'll get half the likes. I think people like the potential. I think people like the process, because, you know, we're all just trying to get better at painting. So I think people see you painting something and it's encouragement. It's, yeah, I'm really excited to see how this ends up. But yeah, I get that all the time. I think my work in progress pictures are...
I'll just be excited and then you'll feel compelled maybe to finish it off.
I could.
We've had some excellent cyborg conversions on our Hobby Roundup show. I think Matt Garside, who featured in one of the Armies on Parade awards that you involved in towards the end of the last year, he's been working on some excellent super cyborg war boss conversions of all sorts of fantastic orc goodness or orky goodness from across the Warhammer ranges. There's some inspiring conversions out there, so it'd be good to see what you can work on as well.
I'm so excited to do Hangout and hobby roundup even, because I'm just gonna be so excited all the time. I love seeing other people's work. That's like one of the things I'm really eager to get cracking on. And if we can do an orc themed one, that would be cool just for me. Selfishly speaking, can we do a hot
And what is the style? What is your recipe for orky skin? Is that something that you've refined, finished up over the years?
That is very exciting. It's changed over the years. Since this is an army I've had for a very long time, the styles changed, the recipes have changed for my painting, that's changed. Originally, I think I mentioned this in my previous podcast, I painted the orcs green and then decided the right color for their armor was green, and that's not a good decision. So I was having a look at my old orcs last night, because I was kind of, you know, looking through them, seeing what was good again, because it's been so long since I've had a game with them, which is a shame. And I kind of saw the cutoff point where I stopped doing that and started, you know, like I said before, doing something different. And I started painting them with snake armor. So I would do some research into some snakes. And there was those ones that, are they corn snakes? That have like the red and the white and the black stripes. And I think, well, you know, orcs and red is just such a great mix. I think I went with that. And then you've got the white and the black stripes, which again is very orky. You can do a lot of orky stuff with that. So if you look at my newer stuff, it's the classic green, but with that kind of corn snake, red, white, and black armor. And I think that looks, I'm happier with that than green on green. I think the recipe as it went was wag flesh, beel tan green, then maybe lorn forest up to moot green with a highlight of ogryn camo, and then a wash or a glaze of just, I think it was Waywatcher back in the day, but honestly, any bright green contrast paint will do just as fine. And I think that was my recipe for them, which is why they're very lurid, very bright.
Yeah. And how do you do the war paint or tattoos or anything over the top of that?
I think it's not so much the paint I use as the amount of time you give it. Every single orc boy that I have in my army has individual tattoos. And that's a lot of orc. Yeah, I probably get some pictures for some examples, but every single one has individual tattoos, except for two, which are called the twins, which I did exactly the same. And if one dies in the game, the other one goes with them. And because they're such good friends, they're the twins. But it's all about patience. It's all about just giving them their own custom personality. And it's just, white paint, taking your time, making them look individual.
was having a look at your squiggoth again on one of the photos on Instagram, and that the panels of armor, the red and the kind of bone whites with that dirty brown shading in there. I can see how that emulating the patterns that you'd see on the snakes. Once you step back and see that repeated across the whole army, that must be a nice little guide where you can see how you can apply that to the different kits that you've involved.
One of my favorite ones is doing planes, because they have that kind of long snake body anyway. So I think my orcs, when they look up, they just see flying massive snakes and they're like, this is great. I love this because I do this snake pattern along the body of the plane. Mm-hmm. And that's a really good tie-in as well. Lots of snakes. Mm-hmm. They like snakes.
Like snakes. They like eating snakes and carrying snakes around.
Oh, yeah.
We're talking about that Headcracker. Headcracker's Mad Mob, the upcoming Warhammer Warband. Another great green skin kit with snake in hand. I've already seen people doing fantastic kit bashes and conversions using that.
I don't think I'm going to be kit bashing that. I've got it in my drawer right now, ready to paint. And he looks like Wurzag's brother. And I love that. And I love the mask of Wurzag, the kind of like tiki mask almost. It's just great. It's such a good look. I'm really excited to paint that warband, but I don't think I'll be converting it because I have been getting back into Underworld. So I think I do want to be actually playing that as it is. And I just love the miniature so much. I'm really excited.
Well, before we talk about what you will be converting or kit bashing in the future, on the painting, how do you treat everything else that isn't orc skin or the armor that you've identified and taken the ideas from the corn snake, the leathers and the furs, the kind of natural, naturalistic textures? What's your approach for doing those?
Depends what it is. I think since I painted a lot of these back in the day, a lot of the methods are pretty simple. There was a lot of dry brushing. I still like to keep it bright, but a lot of it is freehanding. I really like freehanding. I like painting textures onto textures. I like adding things. A lot of the furs and stuff, I've put like leopard print, if we can see that. There we go. Yeah. Leopard print and things like that. And apart from that, it's making it dirty. It's making it look like it's come out of a jungle. So it's either, you know, for the boars, making it look like it's furry, making it look like it's got lots of texture to it. It's a lot of texture work. I think any orc player will tell you this, is that a lot of it is weathering and chipping and making it look dirty and not clean. But yeah, I think it contrasts quite well with the very clean orc skin that I do. It just makes it stand out. Yeah.
I love the mix of ogre beasties and seraphon reptilian beasties, because you've got things that we associate with the sweltering jungles of Lustria and things we associate with the frozen mountains of the Morn or the mortal realms, but they're all part of the same orky ecosystem, I imagine.
Yeah,
pulled them all together and it just gives you more textures to play with, because then you've got things with scales on them and things with furs on them. That bone splitter savage orc kit is full of both of those sorts of things.
Shields are one of my best friends in the orc army. The savage orc kit comes with a load of shield. They make great hubcaps for battle wagons, and I think the shields on the thunder tusk, the ones that go all over its body, that was one of my favorite things to paint of recently, because let me get one over here. Just all the scales and stuff, just really nice textures. I've gone for like an egg pattern on those because I wanted them to look like snake eggs almost. And I think orcs in general are just a great kit for experimenting with different things, because you can add what you like to your orc army and what you think works for you. And if that's adding a lot of fur and a lot of scales, then you can do that. It's really good.
Have you mapped out this feral orky planet that your snake bites crashed into? Have you got it worked out in the way that humans would work it out, or just a very orky sense of it's got monsters on it?
I have it in, it's in here, Wade. As all good homebrew, it's all in my head. I would love to do a map of the orc encampment where they live, or just like the area where all these orcs exist, because it is in my head and I can see it there. But you know, as a map person, I guess I don't really have an excuse for not doing that, so I really should get on that. That could be a really good thing to do, actually. Ooh, Wade. I like that idea. Yeah, I should definitely do that. But yeah, it's all up in my head right now.
And have any of the games that you've played with them, has that built up the kind of head canon? Have any of the people that you've played against, have you involved their armies in the history of your orcs?
A little bit. Yeah. They all add something. A bit more for my friend's army, who I play against quite regularly. You know those battlements that you get? He played Sisters, and they had those 40k battlements. A lot of them have little boars drawn on them, and no boys allowed written on them. So the snake bites got real up close and had a good sketch on those. And that was my addition to, I guess, his army. I hope he still has those. That would be really great.
And do you include trophies of defeated enemies in the collection? Is that something that you work
in? I do, but subtly. For example, all the claws I use are from, basically, the war bosses inherit the claws. So all the conversion claws I do in the lore, my lore, is that they've stolen it from another war boss. They didn't have that to begin with. They've essentially stolen all these trophies that they have. And so I think that's how I've incorporated that.
So do you think you'll maybe use similar sorts of claws in future war bosses if someone should rise to challenge Skagrim, Snake Eater, and take over the tribe? Would there be a claw as a symbol of force, essentially?
Would they, though? That's the question. Do I potentially get a third war boss to take on? Oh, that could be fun. Maybe. Yeah. And then they would inherit the claw. They would get the even bigger claw and the even bigger stick, which again is those things I put on the back of the miniatures, and that shows their prowess. I'd have to make it even bigger than the two war bosses I already have, which would be a challenge, but I'm up to it.
That is the nature of orcishness, really, yeah. Isn't it? Just to keep making them bigger and bigger.
Yeah. Who's got that? Yeah. That's it. Who's got the biggest silly stick that they can whack the other war boss with? Yeah.
The biggest green skin I've seen yet is converted from a bloodthirster.
What?
The mighty Olrog. He was a green skin. Of the
yes.
Which is a hobbyist who's a big fan of the Orks. Friend of the show. We've had him on Warhammer Live to play wonderful games with this converted freebie to Orks. But yeah, there's some big green skins. If you let them grow big enough and just keep fighting, it turns out they can just be made out of bigger and bigger Citadel miniatures with big Orks.
There's no end. Has anyone ever done the Beast from 40K? I'd love to see that with a blood. I thought that's where you were going, like a bloodthirster. But the Beast from 40K, who almost killed the God Emperor of Mankind, I believe. That was crazy. That was weird.
I think I have a feeling that the Orks of that time were a bit bigger than the current range of miniatures that we're familiar with might stand up to. Maybe converted Iron Jaws brutes with big guns. Or something like that for the traditional Orks, because the Iron Jaws range, the whole Warhammer Age of Sigmar range of greenskins opens up loads of excellent conversions and kinbashes for particularly liberated Orky converters. So what do you think of for the future? What sort of things are you thinking of adding to this mighty?
Well, honestly, I do want more boys, obviously. More Ork boys, more. I miss painting troops, and I think that's something I want to bring back in my hobby, is painting for armies and for games, because it's something I've not done in so long. So I am eager to get more boys and just really, you know, build my army like that and still make them snake bite, still do all my custom paint jobs and all my tattoos and stuff, but just get some more troops on the ground. Apart from that, obviously very excited for the Beast Snaggers. So excited for that. I'm going to be, you know, getting that set and hopefully painting it up to completion. And the little squig on like the gyro wheel, who's just going around, I'm so excited to get my hands on him. Of course, I've talked about some of the conversions I'm really excited to do, like the mega dread with the rogue idol face. And just, I know we're not supposed to like putting LEDs and things, as I know some people hate that, but I really want to put LEDs in the back of the mask and switch him on so he's actually glowing with magic. I'd love to do that. I've never put LEDs in anything. I like them. Some people are really against them. I like LEDs. More LEDs.
Not a hill I'd die on, but opposition to diodes. I think they look fantastic. It's terrifying to me. I could barely do any sort of school level electronics, let alone.
Oh yeah, I did electronics in high school. I can totally do this. It's fine. Right. It's fine. Yeah. Apart from that, I'd like to do another armies on parade board with all the new miniatures. I say this about everything I'm excited about. I'm like, yeah, they get an armies on parade board. I've got some unpainted squigs that need painting and squigoths that need painting. So there's a lot to add to the army. I just need the time to do it, but Beast Snaggers is going to be, I think, the big push for me to start painting my army again and really getting back into it. Because like I said, it's been a long time since I've focused on my snake bites, which is why I really enjoyed this. This has been so much fun.
Have you had a chance to play any games of 9th edition Warhammer 40,000?
Not yet. Not yet. No, I haven't. And it will be with snake bites because, you know, Warhammer World is now open, and I had my first game in maybe 2 years the other day with my Zinch army, and it really put it the fire back in me. I'm ready to go again. I'm ready to get my armies back on the table and really, you know, give some people a good crumping.
I saw the pictures of your Zinch game, looked absolutely stunning, and congratulations on picking up the victory, I believe, didn't you?
Yes, thank you. It was only a small game, only 700 points against Drakari, though, which are very, very nasty, I think. Lots of bikes, lots of Drakari bikes, but the Screamers quickly ate those up, which is great. But yeah, I got the victory on that. I'm really excited to get my snake bites on the board again for a bigger game. Big 2,000 point game would be great. Right about now.
Play some Crusade games if you're maybe expanding the narrative. If we could get some like Warhammer TV 40k games on there. Pitch and myself have some grudges that we need to settle, and that's always good for a battering with either his Drakari or his Ultramarines. But I'd love to go and investigate this Orcish world of yours. Maybe send my Flesh Terrors in to go and have a good look around.
We would like that. I'm up for some good grudges. I need some more grudges in my life. Yeah.
I've also got a little Catachan combat patrol I was working out. So if you've got some lush jungles on this Orky world where these fantastic dinosaur-looking beasties ridden by Orcs come from, maybe I'll send in the Catachans.
That seems thematically correct. I love the idea of the Catachans essentially entering Jurassic World, but Orcs.
Oh, this is not what we planned for at all. And dinosaurs. Fantastic.
And dinosaurs.
Good times. Well, thank you so much again for spending the time to talk about your love for your Snakebite Orc collection. It looks absolutely stunning.
And thank
now you. We've got a bit of insight on how it came to be and what you're thinking of adding to it in the future.
Cheers. Thank you so much. Like I said, this is the podcast that I think every hobbyist that has their own homebrew is just so excited to do. And I got to do it today, and it's reignited my love for my oldest army, which is absolutely great. So I've had the best time. Thank you so much, Wade.
You're very welcome. And thank you to everyone who's tuned in to listen to or watch this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. We'll see you again very soon.
Bye.